Cortona, appointing this time, is really a very joyful occasion. And I share this joy with you. And it is also a time for deep gratitude on my part, especially to Luigi, who has made it possible to continue the Cortona week, and to all the wonderful young people, the poor staff, helping and prepared everything so well. So I'm profoundly grateful to you, Luigi. I really hate to talk with my back to you. Okay.
Come and sit here, Luigi. Come and sit on the front, so that it's easier.
And all those of us who have been at Cortona before, Cortona weeks, know that we are really in for fun. We are in for a good time. And that is very important, that is really part of the Cortona weeks. It's a week of having a real good time. However, it is also a time of serious work, and not in spite of the good time, but we're having such a good time because it is also a time of serious work. And serious work presupposes that we clarify the terms which we are going to use during this time. Because a clear language leads to clear thinking, or is connected to clear thinking, and clear thinking leads to clear, that is focused, action. And this is another important aspect of the Cortona week, that we are not just a good time and then it's over, but they are beginnings of action for everybody who is here. We take with us something that we will put into practice. All those who have been to Cortona weeks know that, and all those who are here for the first time will certainly experience that. It is in many cases, a life-changing experience, but in every case, it leads to action. So clear thinking, clear language, clear thinking, clear action. And Luigi has given me this somewhat pompous title, The Mystery of Life. And so we are confronted at least with two very important terms about which we have to think and which we have to clarify, and that is mystery and life. To start with mystery, it's probably good to remember Albert Einstein's very well-known sentence, the most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. Einstein says, the most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. And mystery, not in some vague sense. He speaks then in that same paragraph of also about the mystery of life. Mystery not in some mystifying sense. When I speak here about mystery, I speak, can be very clearly stated, about that which we cannot grasp, which we cannot intellectually grasp, which we cannot get into our grip, but which we can understand. There's a great difference between grasping and understanding. We can understand mystery if in turn it grabs us, it takes hold of us, as a relationship between us and mystery. If that sounds abstract to you, think quite concretely of music. You have just been hearing music, a beautiful piece. Who of us can grasp music, the essence of music? We can talk about it, we can analyze, we can say many things about music, but nobody can grasp the essence of music and write it out in a formula. So, however, everybody who has a little bit of music ear can understand music, and that means it happens when music speaks to us, when music does something to us. It grabs us, it takes us away from where we were, and leads us somewhere else. It does something with us. There's a relationship between us and music. One of my Zen teachers used to say, oh, you in the West, you always say you want to understand, but what you really want is overstand everything. Grasp, stand over it and grasp it. Stand under it. That is understanding. And you are like people that stand in the shower with an umbrella up, you say. So we don't want to be that kind of thinkers. We want to understand, we want to be engaged with ultimately with mystery. Another area in which we can experience mystery is poetry or art in general. And Rainer-Maria Rilke, in his very famous, one of the most famous poems, A Creed Torso of Apollo, describes this piece of art, Greek torso, and he describes it in such a way that we are totally drawn into this. And at the moment when we are all eyes, as we say, in the poem, at that moment, and it's the middle of the next to the last line of the poem, he suddenly switches and says about this piece of art, there is not one spot that does not look at you. And then the last line, you have to change your life. This is the moment in which we are confronted with mystery. It is the moment where the aesthetic experience moves over to the transcendent experience. The transcendent that so transcends, so goes beyond even our understanding of transcendence, that it is completely compatible with immanence, that it is completely compatible with finding what you find in this piece of art, in this piece of music, in life, as we will see as we go. The moment where you no longer just feel that this is nice and beautiful, but where it goes to your heart, the whole person is engaged. That is the moment of contact with mystery, of transcendence. Not in the sense of leaving the immanent behind, but the transcendent that is so transcendent that it includes the immanent. Most of us are familiar with this also from what Maslow calls, described and studied as the peak experience. And actually, Maslow originally called it the mystic experience. That means the moment of all oneness, the moment of encounter with mystery, and only later, fairly soon, because in psychological literature, mystery and mysticism didn't sit so well, so he very soon changed it to peak experience, but all his life he insisted that what he called peak experience could not be distinguished from what we know as the mystic experiences of literature and of the writings of the great mystics. And he also said that to the extent to which one can generalize in psychology, every human being has these mystic experiences. The difference between the great mystics and the rest of us is that the great mystics let the fullness of that experience flow into their everyday life. And what we can try at least is do a little bit of that. Let this encounter with mystery flow into our life. And that belongs very much to this mystery of life. But we're still talking about mystery and about the encounter with mystery. Actually, at this point, one should probably also make at least one passing remark about the G word. Where does God come into this whole thing? First of all, it's important to remember that the very word God, the root from which the word God comes, means is neuter. It's a neuter word. It's neither masculine or feminine. It's not a goddess or a god, but it means that which is called upon, the called upon, or that which calls us, because there's not much point in calling about something without having this relationship. So the most amazing aspect of this mystery that we cannot grasp, but that grasps us, is that at the same time we are part of it and in the relationship with it. This is absolutely paradox, but when we speak about ultimate reality, we just expect to be in the midst of paradox. We are part of it. In every great spiritual tradition, this is expressed. In the Christian tradition, it's in the book of Acts, 17:28, a very important passage where St. Paul speaks not to Christians, but to humans as a human. He doesn't speak of the Christian teacher's tradition. He is stranded in Athens. He talks with the philosophers in Athens because he has to wait there, has nothing else to do. And he cannot presuppose anything from them except that they are also human beings. And so he says to them, your own poets have already told you that. Very important. And he refers to the poets at this point. Poets, poetry is the only language that can carry that much weight. And so he says to the Greeks, your own poets have told you that. In God, and he uses this word God, in God we live and move and have our being. The old Luther translation is so beautiful, in God we live and weave and have our being. It is like all these relationships that are interwoven, that is the fact, and have our being. In God and God in us, totally in God, totally. God told us, not like the fish in water, but like the drop in water. Yeah. In this mystery, as the drop is in the ocean. And yet, we can have a relationship to it. We can be related to it. It speaks to us. And that relationship is experienced by all of us in the course of our life, under the aspect of three great
existential questions that no human being can avoid in the course of life. And the great question of why and what and how. The question why, sooner or later, leads us into silence. And it's important to remember that the word mystery comes from mue, to keep silence. Mystery and silence are, in some respects, simply two words for the same reality, this silence. Ultimately, when we ask why, we come to asking why there is anything rather than nothing. And at that point, we reach into that depth of mystery. We cannot say anything anymore. It would be a betrayal of the reality if we said anything. But out of this silence, out of this why is there anything out of nothing, out of this nothing comes everything there is. And if with a really open mind, with the mind of children, which all of us have still with us, because childhood is too short to become the child that we are meant to be, with that openness of the child, we look at anything, we still experience that nothing out of which it comes. Not as separate, but as one. And out of that silence then comes everything. And here's where we ask the question, what? What is it? Not only everything, but every person, every animal, every plant, every experience, every situation. What is it? What is it? And the answer is, in the context and in the language that we are just now speaking, out of that silence comes word. Ultimately, whatever there is can be understood as a word. Of course, not the kind of word that you can look up in a dictionary, but word in the aspect that it speaks to us. There is so much going on right now, everywhere in this room, at every moment, so much is going on, and we